So currently we are in McMurdo Sound, which is where the New Zealand and main American bases are located in Antarctica. On its eastern side, it's bounded by Ross Island, and then on the western side, bounded by mainland Antarctica. It's not a true sound either, because its southern end is defined by the front of the ice shelf, which is not land, but a large floating shelf of ice. So the ice that we're standing on now is only about 1.5 meters thick, because it's actually only formed over the previous winter. And what's actually interesting about what's happened in this previous winter is that it really didn't start forming properly until September. So we've only had a matter of weeks for it to get as thick as it is, which is actually pretty surprising that it's got this thick. So to the south of us, we have the very large Ross ice shelf. You can think of that as being about the size of France, or, you know, sort of twice the size of New Zealand. And that's made up of thick ice that's rolling off the continent. So it's up to 700 meters thick back at the base, and then thinning to about 300 meters. And that's all floating on top of the ocean. Then we come out here to the sea ice, which at its greatest extent can cover an area about equivalent to Antarctica itself. So that's another 50 times the size of New Zealand. And that will grow to a thickness of between 1 and 2 meters thick over that area. And of course, it's called sea ice for a reason. It's made from ocean as it freezes. And so Scott Base occupies quite an interesting location. It's right at that intersection between the front of the ice shelf and the southernmost part of the sea ice. And that's what's really interesting for me, because I'm interested in the connection that the ocean makes between the ice shelf itself and the sea ice coming forward to the north. So because we're connecting from the ice shelf to the sea ice with the ocean, the water that we're actually sampling is super cooled, which means it's below its own freezing temperature. It wants to freeze, but it hasn't had much chance to freeze. And it's carrying with it tiny wee crystals of ice called frazzle. And those frazzle crystals will grow and grow until they get to a point where they're big enough that they'll have to float up until they land against the base of the sea ice above them. And in some places here in McMurdo Sound, that can grow up to a layer of the order of 6 meters thick in a single season. Here where we are now, we're a bit further to the north, so we've only got about a meter of that platelet ice underneath the sea ice. People have known about platelet ice for over 100 years, but what's really unique about what we're doing here is that we're actually able to core that delicate structure without breaking it up. So that means we're collecting a sample that contains the ice and the water and all the plants and animals that are associated with it, without it all breaking up and getting destroyed. And that's a really new capability. Okay, so our initial step is to set up the site, and here you can see us drilling first of all our sample hole, where we'll ultimately collect the sample, and then next to that we'll drill our well hole, and that allows us to flood our sample hole with water without actually breaking all the way through the sea ice. And the reason we have to do that is we have to maintain what's called hydrostatic balance. If we don't do that, when we do ultimately break through the sea ice, the water is going to flood through to fill that hole. But if we've already filled it, then it won't do that and won't destroy the sample that we're about to collect. So then the next step is we mount our actual drilling system over the hole that we've started with. And here you can see we've got a carbon fibre tube that is actually our core barrel for sampling. And on the end of that is a cutter head that is going to cut through the last few centimetres of sea ice. I think we're leaving ourselves about 40 centimetres of sea ice left to cut through. And so we're going to stop the drill. You'll see it happen just as we cut through the bottom of the sea ice and before we start munching into the platelets, because we don't want the drill mucking up our sample. So at that point, we disconnect from the drill and take that away. We've got no further need for it. Now comes the plunge, where what we're doing now is dropping that core barrel down through the platelets, and you can think of it like an apple corer, just chopping straight down. And as soon as that's done, then we've isolated our entire sample from the ocean. It's there inside our core barrel and ready for us to collect. So the next thing we do is we just collect off that that piece of sea ice that's left. So to do that, we reach down and get an ice screw onto it so that we can physically grab it, which isn't as easy as it sounds, because now it's bobbing about. It's free floating in the water that's in the tube. And here you can see that there's some algae that are attached in the bottom of the sea ice, and there'll be more of that to come in the platelets as we bring them up. And so then the final step in the whole process is to now apply our vacuum cap onto the surface of the sampling tube, and then we apply our vacuum and the rest of the sample, which is now made of ocean water, platelet crystals, and the biology that's within it, is gently brought up to the surface, and we just take it off in 25 centimeter segments. In terms of the numbers that we're going to take from that, the first thing I'm doing right here is separating the ice and the water so that we can assess what the ratio of ice to water is.
These are the platelets, yes. They're quite mushed right now.
Yeah.
And our expectation is that there'll be more platelet ice at the top with less water, and then as you go further down into the layer, more water and less ice. And then the samples themselves will be taken back to the lab and filtered for an assessment of what the biology in them is. It's really exciting that this new technology has been developed. It allows us to capture the platelets just the same way as they're formed. It's going to give us an opportunity to make discoveries that no one else can do and that we haven't been able to do before, about the physics of the environment, the connection between the ice shelf and the sea ice. But we're also able to make new discoveries about the plants and animals that are using that habitat to support the food chain. We're able to look now to the future to understand what the vulnerabilities of the platelet layer itself might be as climate change takes hold down here. And because we can understand the system in a physical sense, connected with the biology as well, we can start to see how the platelet layer and its changes might have impacts for the whole of the Ross Sea ecosystem.